Thank you, Ian. Good morning and welcome, friends in here, friends out there, wherever there is. It's good to be together as a community of the risen Christ as we continue to celebrate this Easter season. So when our kids were little, I was thinking this week, since we're studying parables this spring, when our kids were little, they watched a show called Wishbone. And there's a little ditty, a little song that begins the show, you know, "What's Your Story, Wishbone?" And it's a way of teaching kids about literature, because this cute little dog named Wishbone enters into a piece of famous literature and plays out one of the characters in the story, and it's a great way to teach kids about literature. So I was thinking on my way here this morning, what's your story, people? What's your story today? Maybe not literature, famous literature, but we're all living a story of some kind in our own personal lives and in the greater story of what's happening in our communities and in the world. But wherever we are in our story, we come to worship knowing that the risen Christ meets us where we are, in the story of our life, and in the bigger story of what's happening in the world. So come with that assurance that God is with us. So let's join together as we enter into worship in our call to worship on the screen, on your monitors at home, and in your bulletins. We are here to worship a remarkable God. The love of God welcomes us. The grace of Christ awaits us. The joy of the Spirit enfolds us. Don't come as slaves, come as the truly free. Don't come as petitioners, come as those who are already heard. Don't come as interlopers, come as invited guests. Don't come as the outsiders, come as much wanted children. The love of God emboldens us. The grace of Christ redeems us. The joy of the Spirit uplifts us. Come as the joyful, come as the eager, come as the thankful, come as the recipients of amazing grace. The love of God overflows our hearts. The grace of Christ liberates our spirits. The joy of the Spirit sings in our souls. As you're able, please stand and let's sing, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing."
Good morning. I'm Arlene Ray Schneider. I've been around for a while, but I've also been not around for a while. But no, I've given up gymnastics, and I'm just going to come back to reading. It's good to see you all, and thank you all for your kind words and good wishes and prayers. We'll start with a prayer of praise. This is the day that you have made. Life-giving God, join us with us in fighting on earth. We will rejoice and be glad this day. You take our endings and you make new beginnings. You surprise and astound us in places where we thought that you were absent. You challenge us to reconsider what is possible. Living Christ, we praise you, for you were raised by the love and power of God. And there is no new creation, and by your grace, we are all. Alleluia, alleluia. And we respond, fairest, for, oh, we singing that one? Oh, I'm sorry, we're singing that one, and you don't want me to sing. Really, I do many things well. Singing is not one of them. Okay. In response, we will sing, fairest Lord Jesus, or lip sync, as the case may be.
Thank you.
join together in our prayer of confession and reflection, followed by a time of silent prayer and reflection. God of abundant mercy and endless patience, we are easily distracted, and in our self-absorption, we stray from your ways. Protect us, good shepherd, from becoming lost in selfishness, fear, or pride. And when you run to find us, help us to let ourselves be found and respond in faith, the faith that trusts that you indeed love us and that we are yours. Let's take a moment for our personal prayers and reflection. Amen. Our words of assurance are actually a prayer of thanksgiving, so let's join together in being assured of God's mercy and grace. Merciful and loving God, we thank you for never losing hope for us. When we are lost, you are there on the lookout for us, bringing us back to you like the good shepherd that you are. You assure us that there is rejoicing in heaven over us whenever we turn to you. May this joy flow into our lives each day and be faithfully reflected to the world around us. Thanks be to God, our great shepherd. Now let's take a moment to pass the peace of Christ to one another with words and signs of Christ's peace as you are comfortable, and may the peace of Christ be yours at home watching.
And now we will hear from Luke, chapter 15, verses 1 through something I can't read. 8. 10. Okay. The story of the lost sheep. By this time, a lot of men and women of questionable reputation were hanging around Jesus, listening intently. The Pharisees, not at all pleased. They were unable to see the words. They growled, "He takes in sinners and eats meals with them, treating them like old friends." Their grumbling triggered this story. Suppose one of you had 100 sheep and lost one. Wouldn't you leave the 99 in the wilderness to go after the lost one until you found it? When found, you can be sure you would put it across your shoulders, rejoicing. And when you got home, call all your friends and neighbors, saying, "Celebrate with me, I found my lost sheep." Count on it. There's more joy in heaven over one sinner's rescue than over 99 good people in no need of rescue. And another, the story of the lost coin. Or imagine a woman who has 10 coins and loses one. Won't she light a lamp and scout the house, looking in every nook and cranny until she found it? And when she finds it, you can be sure she'll call all her friends and neighbors. "Celebrate with me. I found my lost coin." Count on it. That's the kind of party God's angels throw every time one lost soul returns to God. Okay. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks, Arlene. And we'll continue now in Luke's Gospel with Luke 15, 11 to 32, because there's a third parable now in sequence. And next to the parable of the Good Samaritan, which we talked about last week, the parable of the prodigal son is probably the most well-known and beloved of Jesus' stories. Our Presbyterian founding father, John Calvin, called it the gospel within the gospel. All of the good news of the gospel of Jesus is contained in this story. And we're reading all three parables and the little incident that provoked the parables, which you just heard, along with the first two parables, because they're strung together purposefully. I'm going to focus mainly on what we call the parable of the prodigal son, which is not really the parable of the prodigal son, but the parable of the gracious and extravagant father, as we'll see. So let's listen to a familiar story and try to enter into it in our imaginations. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his field to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but nobody gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come home, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him? My son, the father said, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, I want to make two main reflections this morning on this parable, and on all three of the parables, but mainly on this one. First is a reminder that one of the purposes of parables is to find ourselves in them. When Jesus tells his stories, we're invited to relate to a situation or to a character in the story and learn from it. It's one of the main reasons Jesus told stories so often, to draw us in, to teach us about ourselves, and to invite us to look in a mirror, in a sense, and to learn greater truths about ourselves, along with learning more about the world and about God, of course. It's kind of like looking at a good work of art. It tells part of our story and interprets our life to us, and we find ourselves in the art if we're open and willing. So as we hear this story, we can ask ourselves, am I the prodigal? Am I the older sibling? Or am I the gracious and compassionate parent? Sometimes we move from one to the other throughout our lives or at different times in our lives. So where are you today in this story? John Newton, the slave trader become preacher who wrote the hymn Amazing Grace, found himself in this story. He was the prodigal who squandered his inheritance on wild living. And as he said toward the end of his life, it was not I who found my heavenly Father, but my heavenly Father who found me. And so he penned the great line from the hymn, I once was lost, but now am found. Yet while we're invited to find ourselves in here, we're to find God in this story too. This story is profoundly about God and who God is. It reveals God's heart. In fact, Jesus begins the story by saying, a man had two sons. He didn't say, a younger son left home. This is why the parable isn't really the parable of the prodigal son, but the story of the gracious and extravagant father, who actually had two lost sons, because they were both lost, just in different ways. And the father seeks out both of them, out of compassion, as we hear from the parable. Remember last year, the Good Samaritan had compassion, and that Greek word for compassion is the word splagna, which means guts. It means intestines. So what Jesus is saying is that God is moved in God's guts. If God has guts, I guess. Jesus does, that's for sure. The parable tells us that it is God's nature to seek the lost and then to throw a party. And that latter act of throwing a party is really the focus of and the reason for these three parables. It's one of the common threads in all three stories. God and the angels rejoice when the lost are found. This is Jesus' way of saying that he isn't going to grumble at, you know, those sinners the way the Pharisees expected him to. He welcomes them. He makes them his friend. So these stories reveal God's heart of compassion and grace, and the invitation to us is to find ourselves in the story. So again, where do you find yourself in here today? That's the first reflection for us. Second, it's important to notice who Jesus is telling these parables to. He doesn't tell these parables out of the clear blue sky. Hey, everybody, listen up. I've got some good stories to tell you. The audience here is the Pharisees and their minions, you know, the scribes. Jesus is defending his ministry against their complaints that he wasn't fulfilling the messianic job description that was handed to him by them. They grumble that he's hanging out with sinners and tax collectors, you know, people of ill repute. And then he tells these stories. And I love, Arlene read from Eugene Peterson's translation, The Message. I love how Eugene Peterson translates the introduction to the parables. He says, their grumbling triggered this story. And then off he goes and tells three stories. Again, here we make the observation that in all of the Gospels, when the Pharisees describe those outside of the religious fold, they call them sinners, or refer to them according to the cultural label assigned to them: tax collector, prostitute, Gentile, leper, beggar, and so forth. When Jesus talks about them, he calls them lost, or sheep without a shepherd. It's a compassionate approach. Jesus never labels anyone. In fact, when Jesus speaks directly to these people, he often refers to them as friend, or he calls them by their name. He addresses them personally. So here are two very different ways of looking at people, and therefore two different ways of relating to them. Jesus sees people as lost, and that which is lost needs to be found, right? This approach and attitude is encapsulated in what I call Jesus' personal mission statement. This is Luke 19:10, when he says, the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. The Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. He says this after spending an entire evening with Zacchaeus, who the Pharisees had labeled a sinner. But remember that when Jesus first met him, little Zacchaeus, short man up in a tree, he called him by his name. He said, Zacchaeus, come down. I'm coming to your house today. And he made friends with him. In all of this, Jesus is trying to communicate to the Pharisees that God, and he himself, Jesus, is always on the move, always searching, always taking steps toward people, not waiting for them to get their act together first. And so to get his point across, he tells three parables in a row, two short attention grabbers, and then one larger, longer parable to bring the lesson home in a deeper way. And in telling these three stories to this audience, to the Pharisees, Jesus surprises and perhaps even shocks them with his descriptions of what God is like. Let's think of how these stories would have been heard in their cultural context, by the Pharisees in particular. First, God is like a shepherd. I guess that's okay, but shepherds were not held in high esteem in the first century. They were considered low class and even mentally ill because they couldn't get a real job. They smelled bad, and they were loners and nomads. But this particular shepherd in the story leaves 99 sheep by themselves, vulnerable to predators in the wilderness, to go look for one that went astray. That's a bad decision. You cut your losses and you move on, lest you lose more sheep by pursuing just one. So Jesus is comparing God to a low-class sheep herder who, it seems, isn't thinking very practically. Second, Jesus compares God to a woman who lights a lamp to look for a lost coin. That would have been not only shocking but offensive to his hearers. To tell a story to patriarchal Middle Eastern religious men in which the God figure is a woman. God is like a woman who loses a coin, then lights a lamp and searches for it, and then throws a party when she finds it. Third, God is like a father. Okay, that's better image. That's well and good. But a father who gives his son his share of the estate when he demands it. Once again, This is unthinkable in that culture. It would be like a son saying to his father, "Old man, you're not dying fast enough for me. So give me my share of the inheritance now," because it typically was not given until the father had died. In that culture, if a son did this sort of thing, the father's duty was to beat him without mercy. But what does this father do? He gives him his share and lets him go. That's surprising. Then the son hits rock bottom when he takes a job feeding pigs, considered the lowest of the animals. And that adds to the drama of the story because it makes the son as unclean as he can be. He's at the bottom of the pit of humanity. And he's not only feeding pigs, he's trying to eat what they're eating. Then the son comes to his senses and he prepares a speech for his father and hightails it back home, hoping he might be welcomed back just as a servant. Now at this point in the story, the Pharisees are probably thinking, okay, the father let his son go with his share of the inheritance. Now the father will beat him without mercy when he comes home. But Jesus continues the story, and what does the father do? When the father sees his son from afar, apparently the father has really good eyesight, he runs to greet him with joy and open arms, which is undignified for a man in that culture, because in running, he would have had to gather the folds of his robe, literally gird his loins, thus exposing his legs, which was a shameful act for a man in that culture at that time, and still is today in some parts of the world. I have a friend named Leo Walsh, who's a Catholic priest and did part of his seminary training in Egypt, studying the Coptic Church in Egypt. And while he was there, a Coptic priest was fired for walking down the street too fast. Because as he was walking, his gait was kicking up his robe, thus exposing his ankles and lower legs, which was considered a disgrace. He disgraced himself. So that's similar to the type of culture that Jesus is speaking to. For the father to run like that would have been disgraceful. And a further surprise is that honor is showed to the youngest son upon his return. Usually honor is bestowed on older, responsible sons, firstborn sons, who stay home. But the youngest son gets the best robe, probably the father's festival garment. He gets a ring on his finger, probably a family heirloom, and a party with the finest things. And the responsible older son is out in the field, and he's furious about the whole thing. The Pharisees, certainly by now, have found themselves in the story as the older son. And I'm sure they can relate to his anger and frustration at his father's generosity toward the younger brother. So what has Jesus done here by telling this string of stories, especially to this audience? Jesus has taken their understanding of how things ought to be, and who God ought to be, and who they ought to be, and has completely messed it up. He has turned their world upside down and inside out. Now, I don't think Jesus was trying to offend the Pharisees. He certainly hasn't made them happy with his illustrations of who God is and how God works, but I don't think he was trying on purpose to see how offensive he can be to them. What Jesus is trying to do is to show them who God really is. Jesus wants them to see a huge God of grace, of amazing grace. There is grace for the prodigal children who get what they need rather than what they deserve. But the wonderful aspect of this story is that there's grace for the older brother as well. The father leaves the party to seek and find him too, out in the field, because he's also lost. It's just not as easy to identify his lostness, because he's lost in his over-functioning sense of responsibility and lost in his pride. And in a tender moment, the father reminds him of the grace that's been his all his life. "My son," he says. What a tender address. "My son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours." Wow, what a beautiful affirmation. Talk about generosity. And then he's invited to the party. So here are three parables about lost animals, objects, and persons, and about a God whose nature it is to seek and find the lost and throw a party when the lost are found. Now let me try and pull all of this together for us with one last observation that we can take home for personal reflection. The brilliance of this third parable, and what distinguishes it from the first two, is that it's an unfinished story. It's an unfinished story. We don't know if the younger son remained home and lived gratefully and responsibly in the auspices of his father's heart of goodness and grace. Likewise, we don't know if the older brother overcame his pride and self-pity and joined the party after the father went out to him and assured him. The story just ends without resolution. Now, I don't know about you, but I'd like to know what each of these sons did next. But Jesus doesn't say, and it remains an unfinished story. And because of that, it ends with an invitation to us. By telling the story this way, Jesus is saying to us, now you finish the story. What are you going to do now? If you're the prodigal, what will you do with the grace you've received and experienced now that you've been forgiven and celebrated and welcomed home? And if you're the older sibling, can you celebrate the fact that you have a father, God, who has a generous and compassionate heart toward the people you may think don't deserve it? And can you see and give thanks for what you already have and what you will continue to have, that you live in abundance? And for all of us, no matter where we are in our journey or in our story, can we become like the compassionate, extravagant God who, out of a heart of compassion and love and in a spirit of welcome, is willing to embrace all of God's children and spare no expense in welcoming them to God's party of grace? How will you and I finish the story? Let's sing, What Is the World Like? And please be seated. I invite you to join me in prayer now and in the Lord's Prayer, those who would like to say it together. And as we often do here, we'll leave space for you to lift up, either out loud or silently, people or situations that you would like to pray for on your heart this morning. Let's pray together. Loving God, as we continue to celebrate resurrection and new life this Easter season, we can easily become distracted, as we prayed earlier. Distracted by personal concerns, family concerns, by world affairs, by sports and entertainment. And we thank you that you meet us and everyone in each of those things. And at the same time, we pray that we could have eyes that are opened to your presence in the small and surprising ways, so that we don't miss the signs of your kingdom and of new life in the ordinary and the everyday. As we turn our attention toward our neighborhoods and towns and the world, we acknowledge there is so much to pray about. This morning, gracious God, we pray simply for your shalom, that deep peace, to rest on us and upon all. Where tempers are short and where patience is thin, may people know in some supernatural way that they are beloved, and that in the web of our common life as human beings and as part of your creation, which you called good, that we are connected one to another, and that we need each other, and that the earth needs us to be good stewards, and we need the earth and its beauty and abundance. Have mercy, O God, in places of anxiety and of violence, whether in homes or in countries like Sudan. May your deep peace, your shalom, rest upon people, upon leaders of nations, and upon the land. May your shalom rest upon people who need the special grace of healing this day, those looking for work, those recovering from addiction, those facing challenging circumstances. Hear us now as we lift these persons and these situations to you, whether out loud or in the silence of our hearts.
I feel blessed. I meet a new friend this week, and he and his two children are here to worship with.
Gracious God, now as we pray for the world that needs the presence of the risen Christ, may each of us experience the presence of the risen Christ with us from morning to evening throughout our days this week. May the blessing of knowing your presence become a blessing to others we meet. In the name of the risen Christ, we pray, and in his name we pray the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Since we're talking about parables this spring, let's stand and sing, "I Love to Tell the Story." Now, friends, go in peace, and as you go, may the grace of Christ attend you, the love of God surround you, and the Holy Spirit keep you, that you might live in faith, abound in hope, and grow in love now and forevermore. And all of God's beloved said, Amen. Amen.